You may not think about a verbal autistic person needing speech therapy, but they just might. There's a special area called pragmatics that a neurotypical person doesn't necessarily know about, and we kind of just learn, but then we can get confused. So join us as we sort out what pragmatics is and how it's helpful to be in SLP therapy. Welcome to the My Spectrum Life podcast. I'm Jessica, an autism mom. With me is Kelsey and our good speech language pathologist friend, Hillary, as we discuss more about what SLP is.
You're
right. Hey, how are you guys doing?
Pretty good. You?
Good, good. So pragmatics, that was a term that they threw at me when Curtis was first diagnosed. And I was like, what? So what is exactly, can you tell us what pragmatics is?
Yes. Okay. So short definition, pragmatics is social language, anything that has to do with social communication. Now, if you break that into smaller parts, that is all kinds of things. Taking turns, that is sticking with a topic of conversation and not just jumping over to the next thing. There's like a natural transition to, you know, if your topic changes, that's greeting people, that's asking for information, it's requesting things, using different tones of voice for different people, using different types of language depending on who you're speaking to. So when you're speaking to a teacher or your boss, you might speak more formally than you would if you were speaking to a friend. So there's a grand arena of things that you could put in pragmatic language.
Wow. Now, yeah. Kelsey, didn't you just name pretty much a good portion of Curtis's program at one point in time?
Yeah.
I'm psychic.
Go right into that. We were talking the SLP left and right. And it bleeds over with ABA because ABA ultimately talks about with that social skills. And talking about how you would talk to somebody, but actually going down into the details and the smaller components of the how is where SLP is beneficial. Because ABA therapists or a SPED teacher, we're not explicitly taught. We're not, it's not our area of expertise.
So I've done both private practice for speech, and I've done school for speech. And as we've discussed before, the pairing with a therapist is just paramount. You have to be able to have that rapport with the student. You just don't get a good amount of stuff. So tell me the difference of, like, how in the world is, say, if you're in the school system, how do you practice teaching someone how to greet or how to answer the door, per se?
Right. Okay. So typically depending on what the child's goal is, we'll start with the rules. There are rules to social communication. And kids on the spectrum surprisingly really strive with rules and structure. What? I know, right? So we'll go through that first. Then we'll do what I call safe practice, where we'll practice with our friends that usually come with them to group or with me or like another adult. And then we'll try to work on like generalizing those skills because, like, let's just say greeting people. That's a big one that I have a lot. You know, we'll have like an adult walking down the hall, you know, hey, Miss Hillary, hey, Johnny. And Johnny just continues along his way. It's, you know, teaching them to generalize those skills we've been working on. Like, you know, Miss Smith just said hello and he's like, oh, hey. And then eventually, ideally, it gets easier and easier and we generalize that skill.
Because I know for the longest time, and even now, I still, I make Curtis answer the door so that he knows how to answer the door and greet somebody properly. And that was actually for the longest time. Didn't you take some data on that, Kelsey?
We did. We actually did. And she would let us know when somebody's coming so we can kind of prepare him a little better. But he would literally look forward to answering that door at some times. And sometimes he would just open and he'd be like, I'm like, you're supposed to say hi.
Yes.
But it was, we did work on extensively on that. Now he's a pro.
Yeah. He is. So what are some of the other things that you can, So I know that there were a lot of times that Curtis was playing different games and he was doing things like assessing the situation and understanding what all can you, or I know it all depends on the goals. So how do you find what goals you need? And then how do you, how do you help with those goals?
Right. So we give what's called like a pragmatics checklist usually. So we'll give that to the teacher, the parent, and then I'll go in and do an observation and check off what skills I'm seeing and seeing what the child's lacking. And so that's what I use to do my goals, because there are some standardized measures of pragmatics. But if you have a kid that's higher functioning on the spectrum that like knows what the right answers are, but maybe not, doesn't necessarily carry those skills out, they're going to do fine. They're not, and they'll like test out of that, because, you know, one of the questions might be a stranger comes to your door and what do you do? And so a kid that's higher on the spectrum might say, well, I wouldn't let them in the house. But in reality, their mom might tell me that, you know, they open the door every time the mailman's there. They don't know the mailman, you know, that kind of thing. So I typically will use something like that in discussing with the parents what they feel like the biggest lacks are, and then what I'm seeing for them in the classroom.
Right. And correct me if I'm wrong. I've worked with kids with pragmatics, because you're talking about tone and pragmatics. It also goes into email. So I work with the higher kids and trying to get them ready. And I've seen goals as in knowing how to do a salutation and how to formally type and talk within an email and how those tones are. Some of those is that falls underneath pragmatics and like
what you it all falls within social communication. That may, that if you see that in IP, that may be even listed as like a daily living skill, which there are all kinds of things that I work on with my kids. You know, I'm trying to think of some of the like even crazier ones we've had, like how to call someone and order like food, you know, that type of thing, because I personally always make sure to have them tell me the order back so that I'm not upset when my food gets there and it's wrong. Right. And to make sure that you take pauses between the things that you're saying about your food to make sure that they heard everything you said, that they could put it down correctly. And really, you know, when you're working on these skills, especially when a child's like that far along, like those higher level skills, when you explain to them and they understand why you're doing it the way that you're doing it, it's much easier for them versus just saying we do it like that's the way that we do it. It's it's much easier for them to understand the why if you tell them what's going on.
So if you have a child like mine who tests out on paper, how can you make sure they actually are continuing to use the skills that they've learned?
That all comes back to me, at least for me, at least to accountability. Like if you know that he knows the right answers, that means that he should really be able to carry out those skills. And that's just a matter of, you know, you taking like your own personal data of saying, okay, I know that you can greet people, you know, when they speak to you. So I'm going to hold you accountable for that and make sure that, you know, every time someone speaks to you, that you're greeting them and telling them hello, asking them about their day, that type of thing.
Wow. Well, that's a lot to think about. And when you're trying to find somebody who's good, I know sometimes it was difficult for me to find the proper place to put my son, especially when it came to those pragmatics. Will it say, like, when you're researching, like you told us before, we really need to research, will they say that they specialize in pragmatics, or what are some key words that we can look for?
So sometimes for me, at least, I would ask how many years experience some of their therapists have, because I know, at least for me, being that the spectrum of speech pathology is so ginormous, I did not know everything that I needed to know when I first came out of graduate school to be able to help my kids the way that I needed to. But I did my own research and found out things that I needed to know. And some therapists will tell you straight out, be like, I don't work with that many children with autism. And some companies are going to say, well, all of our therapists are equally trained, which is true. We all are. Mm-hmm. But like I've said before, some people are better at other things than others are. So it might take some trial and error. And honestly, if your therapist that you're talking with is more social and more communicative, chances are that's going to be a skill that they're going to transfer to a student also.
That makes sense. That makes sense. That is some great information. Well, let us know by sending us an email of what it is that you have found that has helped you find the proper therapist. And if there's any other pragmatic issues that you are wondering about, by emailing us at info@myspectrumlife.com or
sending us a message or comment at Facebook and Instagram at My Spectrum Life, or you can tweet us at My Spectrum Life with that number one.
And remember, even though our appointment books are going to start filling up with lots of therapy, and it may be to that speech language office, with a lot of faith, love, and tons of fidget toys, we'll make it. Bye.